Namaskar. It's my pleasure and honor to welcome a new guest to P Guru's channel. Meet Ami Ganatra, an IIM professional, a management professional who has been consulting for more than 14 years, and more importantly, an author. And we are going to talk a little bit about her new book. But before we do all that, let's welcome Amiji to our channel. Amiji, namaskar and welcome to P Guru's channel.
Namaskar, Shriji. Thank you so much. I'm flattered to be on this channel of yours with you today. Thank you.
It is our goal to try and bring different perspectives and different, viewpoints. And I was completely, impressed with what you have written or what you've undertaken in your new book. I'll let you explain that in some detail, however much you'd like to share that part. But the most important thing is the untold stories of Mahabharata. I think that's what you've titled your book. And it is such a great pleasure because I have a lot of unanswered questions about Mahabharata. So I'm hoping that you can clarify one or two of these. But by the way, I don't know if you've read this book. It's called The Great Indian Novel. And it starts out very, very interestingly about, it's written in a very breezy style. Yeah. About a certain... Rishi wanting to, he calls up a temp agency and says, look, I need someone to write. And then the temp agency comes back and says, look, the last time we sent you someone, you made that person pregnant. Come on, go take a hike. And then finally, they find one person who's willing to write, a chap from South called Ganpati or something like that. And the guy comes with his bag of pencils Jolpai, I don't know what you call it. We call it in South as Jolna. So he brings that, and then they start writing, and the pencils keep breaking and so on. A breezy way to write about the great Indian novel. The person who wrote this thing, I had a great respect when I read this book, not so much today. That is our Member of Parliament, Mr. Shashi Tharoor. Anyway, so everybody writes about Mahabharata. Everybody goes, takes away something with us. So what made you think about writing this book?
So Shriji, as you very rightly said, I think there's so much written about Mahabharata, and anybody who gets even, who understands the story a little bit gets super interested into it, because there are characters in there to which we all relate to. What has happened though is that because so much has been written about Mahabharata, there have been so many teleserials about Mahabharata. What people know about Mahabharata is from these teleserials and writings. Now, to be fair to a lot of these writings, they don't claim to be itihas. They claim to be fictional accounts of Mahabharata. So they would always say that, I am writing this from Draupadi's viewpoint. Yeah. Now, Draupadi's viewpoint is basically the author's imagination, unless and until it's clearly stated in Mahabharata. Similarly for Karna, so people take the story of Mahabharata and then they give their own twists and turns. Because of that, a lot of people tend to believe that, okay, this is fact. Like, for example, there is this novel, beautiful novel. I have great regard for that writer as well. There is a twist that Draupadi loves Karna or has feelings for Karna. Yeah? A lot of people, trust me, even people I know, they believe that this is from Mahabharata.
Have you seen the movie Kalyu?
No.
1980s?
No, I haven't.
Where Shashi Kapoor acts the role of Karna. Okay. It's a well-made movie. Watch it whenever you get. Kalyu, that's 1984.
Sure. So actually, on Karna, there is lots written, right? Even in Marathi, there's this book called Mrityunjay. One of the very famous books also, I think, translated in English now. Hmm. So Karna is this... hero who's got a raw deal in life. Yeah. So lot is written about Mahabharata from different perspectives. Now, these are all imaginations or fictional accounts from the author's perspective and written so well that they've been established as facts. However, when I started, I got interested in Mahabharata after watching the B.R. Chopra Mahabharata series, but I was much younger then. After that, I read a lot on it. And there was always inconsistencies in the characters. If Karna was so good, why did he behave the way he did during in that game of dice, right? When he was the one to instigate Dushasan to disrobe Draupadi. So there are so many of these inconsistencies. Like, we are shown that Yudhishthir gambled away his wife and he's still called the Dharmaraja. Again, doesn't make sense, right? Why is this guy who actually gambled away his wife, why is he given so much respect in society? So some of these questions were always at the back of my mind. And I said, I cannot find an answer to these unless and until I really go back to the source of it. That was also the time when I had started started relearning Sanskrit. So we'd done Sanskrit in school. I said, "So, chalo, aur kuch nahi karna. I'll pick up Gita Press wala Sanskrit, Hindi, Mahabharat and start from there." So that's how it started. And as I read, there were so many of these aha moments that it was like, oh my God, you know, our understanding is so different from actually what Vyas's Mahabharat is all about. And after reading that, I think I found a lot of answers to the questions I had. And in Vyas's Mahabharat, actually, you don't find these inconsistencies of characters at all. It's very clear. It's very predictable why Karna behaved in that way. Yeah? Was he dealt a raw hand? Probably not so much. Even if he was, it was his own doing rather than anybody else imposing it on him. So eventually it was, you know, like Krishna says in Gita that after knowing and doing everything, yatha ichchasi tatha kuru. So everybody has done yatha ichchasi. Like they wanted, they did. And whatever the results came out of it were based on the karmas that they did. It's very clear and very simple that way, yeah, without any inconsistencies. So I began to relate to the characters of Mahabharat much deeply and much profoundly than after reading Vyas's Mahabharat, than the fictional accounts of it, which made for good reading, no doubt. But the actual gist came from Mahabharat.
Now, you see, if I cast my memory back and look at what the education system in India was up until the 1830s, you had hundreds of gurukuls. And in the gurukuls, what they taught, primarily, they were taught Ramayana, Mahabharat as itihasas. Then they were taught Bhagavat, which is after that what happened. So basically, when somebody went through, they learned it by heart. And it was felt that if you start analyzing all these things and internalizing it, you have enough for you to go and face the world and do what you want to be, what you can be. Now, Mr. Macaulay, put a spoke in the wheel here, and after that it faded away, and I guess that's where all these interpretations came. The British had their own lens that they wanted to look at this whole thing and so on. But tell me something, I'm consumed with curiosity. When you read Vyasa's Mahabharat, how close in Sanskrit was that compared to what is, you know, limited way, very very small way, spoken and written in Sanskrit, written Sanskrit today? How close were the two?
Bhagavad Gita is from the Mahabharat.
Yes.
Right?
Yes,
so the language of the Sanskrit of Gita is the Sanskrit of Mahabharat. I would say, because I can't claim to be an expert in Sanskrit, I could understand quite some of it, but not all of it. So for some of the verses, which even, you know, it's written in the first sarga of Mahabharat, Nadi Parva, that to gain time, Vyas Muni, he composed certain shlokas which were very difficult to understand so that he got time to think and narrate. So there are certain verses in Mahabharat which can be very tricky to understand. The Sanskrit of it can be tricky to understand, unlike Ramayana. I think Ramayana Sanskrit is much easier and closer to what we see today. So is Mahabharat. I think the Bhagavad Gita part is pretty easy to understand once somebody starts getting into the Sanskrit part of it. But there are parts to it. But it is not, you know, what they call the Vedic Sanskrit or anything. It's very close to what we have today. So that's a beauty, another beauty, right? Since so many years, whatever be the timeline that we consider, 5,000 years or 7,000 years for Mahabharat, since then to now, we can actually understand and read that language. So this is a continuity and beauty of the civilization, I guess.
Yes, indeed. And I have my first question for you right away. So is it really true that Ganesha broke his trunk because whatever he was writing with broke, and Vyasa was going at such a hectic speed that he needed something to put something down. So he just broke his trunk and then continued to write. Is it true?
So in the Gita Press version, there is no mention of the breaking of the tooth. It's just that Vyas Muni agreed and it got written. Ganesha agreed and it got written. So they had a deal. Vyasji and Ganeshji had a deal. Ganeshji said that, so when Vyas Muni asked Ganeshji that I have this itihas of my children, because they are the children, right? This Bharat Vamsha, I have this itihas. Will you write it? Because I need somebody of your caliber to write it. And he says, okay, I will write it, but you have to ensure my pen doesn't stop writing. And Vyasmuni, on his end, goes, sure, I will ensure your pen doesn't stop, but you will only write only after you understand what the verse is about. And then, and so Ganesh Ji says Om, and Mahabharata gets written. Now, because Ganesh Ji is Ganesh Ji, right? He writes so fast. Vyas Muni, to get time to think and dictate, he composes certain verses. The number given is 8,800 verses, which are very difficult, in very difficult Sanskrit. So that by the time Ganesh Ji thinks through and understands and jots them down, Vyas Muni has time to actually think through and again start his poem. So that's how it's given. There's no mention of the breaking of the tooth in that.
But somewhere along, somebody had a very good imagination, and perhaps that's how it is. It's a very interesting story. So let's move on to something more. So we got Bhagavad Gita from Mahabharata. We also got Vishnu Sahasranama from Mahabharata. Yes. What other big epics came out of this? I mean, volumes of that thing that they have enough that they can stand by themselves.
So one is Vidur Niti. Vidur Niti is also straight out of Mahabharata, right? The conversations between Vidur and Dhritarashtra. Then the conversations of Shanti Parva, which is between between Bhishma and Yudhishthir. That also comes straight out of Mahabharata. And in fact, in Mahabharata, there are stories which you find in which you find from other Shastras of ours. For example, there is a story of Ramayana. So Ramayana is narrated in Mahabharata. So what happens is Yudhishthira is very upset when they are in the forest and there are many rishis coming to visit him. And he asks one of the rishis that, hey, is there anybody who's as unlucky as I am, who suffered so much in spite of not really doing anything bad to anybody? And the rishi tells him, yes, yes, there is. And he narrates the story of Ramayana. So there are some such stories. There's stories of Satyavati, which are in Mahabharata. But then as standalone, as I mentioned, Vidur Niti, there is this discourse of Bhishma, Yudhishthir. Then there is the Shakuntala story, which comes also from the Mahabharata. So the name Bharat, Mahabharat, comes from Bharat. So the kids, the children of Bharat, right? So the Vamsha of Bharat and the story of Bharat, the birth of Bharat, that comes from from Shakuntala and Dushyant. So that story is from the Mahabharata. Kalidas made it immortal through his play Shakuntal, right? So he picks this story from Mahabharata and puts his flow to it, gives his rasa to the kavya. Interestingly, the Shakuntala in Shakuntal, in Kalidas's Shakuntal, is a lot more, how do you say, she comes across as, you know, who's yearning for her love. And a little bit who needs support, you know, because the intention of Kalidas is to bring out the prem ras, so to say. But if you see Shakuntala of Mahabharata, she is this feisty lady who knows what is good for her kid and who knows what her rights are. She goes to the court of Dushyant, and the dialogues that there are between Dushyant and Shakuntala nobody can say that we were not feminist ever. The way she speaks, she's not scared that, oh, I'm talking to a king or I'm talking to my husband. She proves a point, and even she says it very strongly. In one of the lines when Dushyant is not agreeing to recognize her, she says, you are lying. And, you know, you behave as if you are some big shot. You're lying. Have you ever seen your face in the mirror? She even goes out to say something as strongly as this. Yeah. So that interaction between them itself is very, very beautifully, or rather, you know, it's full of shaurya ras, the veer ras coming from Shakuntala's side. So I've added this story in as one of the stories in the book as well. I think it'll make for an interesting reading. Just the character of Shakuntala being different from the Shakuntala of Shakuntala that we are used to. Then there's the story of Yayati. So story of Yayati, Devyani, Sharmishtha. So because Yayati is also a Purvaj of the Bharatvanshis, right? So he's also one of the ancestors. So his story of the Devyani and Sharmishtha, that itself can be a separate story in itself. That can be separate kavya in itself. So that also comes from Mahabharata.
So fascinating. And I just wanted to establish a link between Ramayana and Mahabharata. What little I have read is that, when Rama finished reigning, then the kingdom of Ayodhya, I think, broke into a few parts. One of them was Kausal, after Kaushalya, Kausal. And Kosal's lineage, the king at the time of Mahabharata war, fought the Mahabharata war on the side of Kauravas. Is that true?
Correct. Okay. Yes. Brihadatta, I think his name is Brihadatta. He fought on the side of the Kauravas.
And see how Dharma takes...
Brihadbal is the name of the... Yeah.
Right. And also, my memory of watching Mahabharata is not very clear, it's hazy, but I still remember that the reason Bharat is known, or Mahabharata is named after Bharat, is because he, when he was ready to demit office, stop being king, he was going to go to Aranya, he decided that none of his sons were worthy of ruling, and he went and picked somebody who he felt was the right person to run the kingdom, rule the kingdom. I mean, so you're talking about democracy being born that far ahead of time. Can you throw a little bit of light on that? Because I think go ahead.
In Mahabharata, the way it is given is that he had 9 sons. He thought he did not find any of them good enough to be his successor. So he undertakes another yagna, and with his wife, he had Rishi Bharadwaj blesses him with a son. Now, is this son a biological son or not is not specified in Mahabharata. Yeah, it just says that he did not make any of his existing 9 sons and undertook a yagna, and through along with his wife was blessed with a son. So this is what is given. So yes, this part is correct, that because he did not find anybody worthy enough, he did not make anybody his successor, and actually waited for the right person to come by. Either biologically or not biologically, actually that's a little bit of a hazy area. They're not clearly mentioned. But yes, but merit mattered, and that is what does come across.
Amiji, a little bit of light on your book. When are you expecting it to be released? Is it going to be released in India? Are you headed back to India soon to release the book? And I'm hoping that we'll be able to give a more critical review of it and have a discussion. In fact, I'll be happy to bring you again and talk about more things from the book. Not only that, I have a feeling that we're going to talk about Mahabharata, Ramayana, what it means to modern day life. This is very important. See, growing up as a kid, I grew up in Hyderabad. I could read, write Tamil, Telugu, Hindi, and so on. Chandamama in Telugu is beautiful. I mean, they write Telugu written, Mahabharata written in Chandamama, 80% Sanskrit, 80%. So you knew exactly, and you knew how to pronounce these names. Some of them are tongue twisters, like Vishwakshena. I mean, this is like, oh my God, you used to, spend time trying to get this thing right. Because, they'll say, you should say this, pronounce it as a young guy, so that otherwise you are, in Telugu they say Nalika Tiragadu, that means your tongue won't twist. So, I'm really, really hopeful that we'll have more such conversation. But a little bit about your book, when are you expecting to release it, and so on and so forth.
So right now, the pre-order link of the book is already up on Amazon India. And I think the deliveries would start somewhere around second week of July. I'm hoping that the Kindle edition, both international as well as for India, will be up next week for pre-order. So mid-July is when the deliveries will start. And for international deliveries, the publisher is yet working out. But I do want to ensure that it can reach as many people as possible, even abroad. Because I have seen that... Indians, wherever they are, Mahabharata is definitely something that everybody is interested in. So
that's absolutely true. In fact, my daughter, who was born here and she has lived all her life here, except for visiting India once in a while, she has a big collection of Amar Chitra Katha.
Wow.
And she knows a lot of this stuff. Plus, she's also, in real life, she's a Bharatanatyam dance teacher.
Oh, wow.
She needs to know itihasa to be able to tell what is what and so on and so forth. But this is more of an exception, but I'm just saying, Amiji, in Colorado for the longest time, how when we were growing up, you used to have something called as non-detailed text. You would learn English, not as an English language, but you would read a book and then you would write about that book as an exam. And it was like, everybody got 100, but it was because you just had to read it for non-detailed text. So in Colorado, Ramayana and Mahabharata written by Rajaji were these books.
Wow.
For a long time.
Wow.
Yeah. So, sometimes, we are in India, we don't know the kind of gems we have in our own myths.
Absolutely. Shriji, I was doing a project. I was on a work stint in Indonesia for about 6 months. And of course, my colleagues were Christians and Muslims. But everybody who was over 40 years, they knew Mahabharata and Ramayana inside out, because that's what they learned even in school. So they said, off late, things have changed. But when we were younger, the only entertainment was for us were through these epics. The performances were based on these epics. The reading was all around the epics. So they know Mahabharata, Ramayana inside out. Of course, in Bali, it's even more. You have all these performances happening on Mahabharata, Ramayana. But even in a common man who's over 40 says that they learned Mahabharata and Ramayana in school when they were younger. And unfortunately, we don't do much in India.
So true. Now, last question before I let you off. Were Duryodhan, Dushyasan's names that, or were they Suyodhan, Sushasan, and then because of their conduct, the things got changed?
No, they are called Duryodhan and Dushyasan.
Okay.
At some places, again, they are called Suyodhan and Dushyasan is always Dushyasan. But Suyodhan and Duryodhan is called Suyodhan somewhere. But while naming, it's very clear it's Duryodhan and Dushyasan.
Right. Thank you so much, Amiji, and I wish you all the best in your new book endeavor. And I have no doubt in my mind, we're going to have many more such interesting conversations. I was just looking at the time that we spent. Time just flew.
And yeah.
I'm hoping that we'll be back again to have more such revealing conversations, because what we want to do is to leave something behind for someone to take away thought. And I'm hoping that viewers, you will support Amiji's work. She is just like you and me. She's got a full-time job, and she found time in her life to, you know, go back to the basics, learn Sanskrit, and then read Vasishtha's Mahabharata, and then come out with this. It's amazing. I'm really looking forward to this book. Thank you very much, and namaskar.
Thank you so much, Shriji. Thank you.